I'm joined now by artist Olivia Perez. Olivia, thank you so much for being here. I looked all through your Instagram last night, and I want to talk about the camper. I want to talk about the dream catchers, but mostly I need to talk about when you started painting skulls.
Yeah, that one kind of, I don't know, I guess growing up, me and my mom and my sisters always did different types of arts and crafts all the time. And we tried to mix it up and do different stuff. And so we would take different classes. And so once you learned one, you'd move on and practice another. And then, I don't know, I think I was more the tomboy of the family and it took a different route. It started probably with dream catchers. And then the more I went, I started incorporating more natural materials. And so you'd go out and collect and see some stuff. And then you would incorporate, I guess, like little bone pieces you'd find or antlers. And then like the bison is my favorite animal. And I acquired a bison skull and I decided to paint it up and put it in my living room. And it was on a coffee table. And I liked that. And then, I don't know, you acquire like a deer, I think, and I put that on my wall. And then when I would do little small art fairs for like the dream catchers and stuff I was doing, I would set that bison skull out there and it was very eye-catching and people were very interested in it. And then, I don't know, I just acquired more.
Let me rewind a little bit. So you, when you were a kid, you were trying out all kinds of different art. Was there something that jumped out to you? Did you realize right away that you were an artist?
No. I'm only just now sitting in this chair kind of picking up on some of that.
Yeah.
It was just something I did for fun or to make a gift for someone else. And then it was just nice if your hobby could pay for itself. So I don't know. I got invited to, I think, like an art fair or a craft fair or something, and then just kind of kept going from there a little bit.
So obviously your work is good. They don't just let any, you know, hobbyist do these shows. So how do you improve on your work that you didn't really set out to make work?
Yeah, I suppose just trial and error. And I'll talk to a lot of people. You'll kind of get more interested in one style. And then, like, so if it was just the dream catchers, I knew people that would go out on hikes and we would find different materials. And then once it became, like, more skulls, there's a guy that has an oddity shop down the road. And whenever it was, like, a skull I couldn't go out and collect and find myself, I would acquire them from his shop. And then we would kind of talk back and forth of different ways of cleaning and preserving. And then, I don't know, you just kind of mesh ideas and styles and stuff.
So I want to talk about that. First of all, is that still how you acquire your skulls mostly?
Some of the skulls I have gone out and collected myself. I have like family that do like rodeos and stuff, and they have like cattle.
Yeah.
And so whenever an animal doesn't make it, it'll get put into the backfield, I suppose, to like naturally decompose.
Yeah.
There's not like a cemetery for them.
Right.
And I will go out sometimes and try to get what I'm gutsy enough to touch and clean. And then some of the other pieces, yeah, I'll acquire probably from his shop or other places.
I'm glad that you just said when you're gutsy enough, because yeah. I feel like to go out into what is not a cemetery, but essentially a cemetery,
yeah.
It takes some guts. So is that something that you weren't always willing to do?
No, no.
So you just sort of realized that it was a necessity.
Yeah, I knew I could probably do something cool with that skull, and I want that skull. But sometimes it's not the most fun to go get it.
Yeah. Okay. So I without getting graphic, how do you go about cleaning and preserving?
There's different like chemicals and stuff you can do. Like I'll wait for them to be like completely decayed before
right.
I'll really mess with it.
Okay.
So nature kind of did most of that cleaning process.
Right.
And then just like you power hose it and you'll use your soaps and chemicals. There's Like, I have a turkey fryer in my mom's barn with, like, a propane tank. And then there's, like, a system where you'll kind of clean it up a bit.
So is that, do you Google that? How to clean a skull?
It's just kind of word of mouth. You'll ask one person, like, people that do hunt, they'll kind of know how they get theirs, like taxidermists and stuff like
that. Sure, that makes sense.
I do not hunt or do any of that stuff.
Yeah.
But you'll just kind of hear them. So one person might have one style, one will have another, and you just dabble in a little bit of all of them.
You said earlier that it's worth it to go out and get a skull if you see it and say, I could do something cool with that.
Yeah.
What is it about a particular skull that makes you drawn to it?
I've always been very interested in, like, that Southwestern style or boho style.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's, like, a big prime piece, like skulls and stuff like that. Are that,
yeah.
And then just something about taking, like, all of my art is made with, like, all natural materials, and so almost everything I've incorporated had some type of a life cycle where it was, you know, born or started from a seed. Some of it I'll have dried floral.
I was gonna ask about that. So you have, I've seen a lot of, like, dried roses.
Yeah.
And how do you acquire that? Is that something that you literally let it live its life in your home, and then when
those,
it's ready?
I'll go out and purchase. Mm-hmm. I would like to eventually start growing my own, but that's a whole nother hobby.
Yes.
I would have to get started.
Yeah.
But just the idea of something going from, like, a life to a death, and you feel like you can repurpose that and reuse it. Mm-hmm. And hopefully give it a second life if you can.
It's so interesting because at the end of the show, I always say, enjoy something beautiful. And if I'm being completely honest with you, I would never have thought that I would look at a skull and go, that is beautiful.
Yeah.
But you really do make them beautiful. How do you, when you start, especially painting, do you know what the end result is going to look like? Or do you kind of let it take on its own life?
It's different. Like, some of them, I might have, like, a certain style or maybe color scheme I want to incorporate. And I would wait till I had a piece that I felt matched it better. Or sometimes you'll look specifically at the skull and kind of dance around with it. So anything that has, like, horns, that one I would usually go for more of, like, a Southwestern style.
Mm-hmm.
And some of them aren't always in the best conditions. I've had some that are pretty mangled. I mean, like, little woodland creatures will go in and kind of go at the skulls, and that they'll shave their teeth on it, and it leaves little ridges, and that's how they get their calcium. And it's like, well, it's not always the most perfect shape, but you try to come up with something. So some of them, if they're a little more had more wear and tear onto it, you would have to go with more of, like, an earthy style to it and kind of keep that natural process. And then other ones that are smaller, maybe, like, that Southwestern design wouldn't go so well on such a smaller piece.
Mm-hmm.
Or depending the skull, maybe that animal wouldn't be indigenous to that area, and you would try to go with more of, like, a boho style or whatever.
So do you like sketch and doodle and then kind of wait for the right skull to use that sketch?
Yeah, I think an eraser is probably my favorite tool in the world. I erase a lot and restart a lot. So sometimes I'll do it on paper, and sometimes I'll just take a pencil and eraser on top of the skull and do my design first before I would ever touch it with, like, paint or anything.
Yeah, because is there a point of no return? If you start painting, I imagine it's hard to go back.
It just might turn, it looks like we're going a different direction
because
you might have messed up one way, or, you know, maybe you can hide it and cover it up with a different detail.
Yeah.
Just, you got to be creative in that aspect when you mess up, because there's a lot of mess ups.
Is there a certain type of paint that works well on skulls? Or does it matter?
I don't know. I'm just kind of learning. I've incorporated, like, sometimes if you're doing, like, fine line work, I might do, like, some, like, pen or marker work.
Mm.
And then there's times where I've done more probably acrylic. Mm-hmm. I've used spray paint. I've got different stuff.
Wow. Okay, so I have to talk about your camper because it's so cool. So how did you acquire the camper?
I was looking into it. I thought I wanted just to take a road trip, and so I wanted something super small. And then the more I kept, shopping for one, it was, the same price for something that's slightly bigger. And I was like, maybe I could get a dual purpose out of it and try to make the art go more mobile and let it take me some places. So
you completely redid this camper, and now you spend a lot of time in it, and that's your artwork is now mobile.
Yeah.
So how is that working? It's
still pretty new right now. I had a ton of chances to use it specifically for that, but I like to travel, and the goal of some of the money from the art, if I make, a profit, it would be cool to travel.
Yeah.
So if I could do a 2-in-1.
Why do you think art is so important?
It's a great outlet. It is. It's nice. Something to channel in and focus on and kind of break away from all the other stuff happening. It's a good outlet.
Do you think that even if no one ever saw or appreciated any of your work, you would still be doing it?
Yeah. My house is full of stuff I've made. And so it's if someone else wanted it, that's groovy too.
Yeah. Wow. I think that has to be the best way to get your work out into the world. Mm-hmm. With, you enjoy it, don't enjoy it.
Yeah, I'll put it somewhere.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I love that. Olivia, you are fascinating, and I can't wait for you to come back after you go on a road trip, because I'm sure that you will acquire some really
put
cool stuff.
Here.
Yes, let's do it. Thank you so much for sitting down with me.
Yeah, thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
Arts in Focus on PBS Fort Wayne is funded in part by the Our Foundation and the Community Foundation of Greater Fort Wayne.